Today we're going to talk about the Canon EF 100 to 400 Mark II. I'm going to use it adapted to the Canon R6. I shot with it for a whole week and I can't wait to share with you how I felt about it. This was my first time shooting with a super zoom or a super telephoto. I've never shot with anything over like 70 to 200. So this was a really fun experience. I learned so much about what that focal length is like, that like 200 to 400 range, which is what I want to focus on. Shots that were taken in that range. I already have a video about the RF 70 to 200, so I've kind of covered how beautiful that is. But what is the 200 to 400 range like? What does that offer you? What kind of changes and difference? Is it worth upgrading or buying a lens in that range? So let's talk about all that stuff. First, I want to thank Movri, who sent this lens to me through the mail. They have a very modern, amazing service that just ships stuff to you. You pick it up on the day when you're ready. You deliver it on the scheduled day when you're done, and you don't have to worry about, you know, is the store open on Saturdays? Do they have like a 4-hour window range? I tried to rent something recently and I literally couldn't even give them my money because I had to work at the hours that they needed the lens back. Their store wasn't open. So, you know, go with Movri, give them a shot. This is the way I think things need to go. It was just so easy and convenient. I thought that this lens, I'd be in my backyard shooting birds and squirrels and all kinds of wildlife and stuff, and that lasted about 5 minutes. I was bored to death of shooting that kind of photography, and to be honest, it didn't even really work. The 400 is still not enough to shoot wildlife, animals that are running about, that are just going to run away if you get too close. Maybe 600 millimeters is a closer range or more, I don't know. I'll have to explore that next and see what even further zooms are like, if I can get some kind of wildlife, but you're not going to be happy with this lens shooting wildlife. It is great for the zoo, however, where animals are at a set distance, you can kind of walk around them and take great shots, and I had a fantastic time with this lens at the zoo. Every animal turned out great. I did learn a little quick lesson about shooting faster at 400 millimeters. You need your shutter speed up at that 400 range or higher, or you're gonna get some blurry photos. The R6 does have IBIS, but it still missed a couple shots, even trying to keep up with my shaky hands. So do keep that shutter speed high. But that said, I got some really, really sharp photos. I was super happy with how well this lens adapted, how well it handled. I had some autofocus issues with the cage in front of the animals. I kept trying to grab the fence. But I learned a really cool trick for shooting at this range. If you try to get it and it shoots and it autofocuses on the fence, twist the manual focus so that it just gets the animal into view and starts to clear it up, then trigger the autofocus and it'll snap to it every single time and find the eye. That's a really great way to get around any kind of foreground object, because you'll see in my past videos, I was fiddling around with the LCD trying to, you know, pick the little eye of an animal. So this is just a way more convenient way to get your autofocus if something is just wonky. The last thing I'll say about the zoo is, who wants to buy a specific lens for just shooting zoo animals unless you're, you know, there every week or something that is just your thing? I don't see a point in getting a lens like this just for one kind of event scenario that you're going to go to once in a blue moon. And then lastly, I took this out on the street to warm up just to see. I always like taking a lens downtown Burlington just to shoot a few people, shoot some scenery, some water, just get a feel for what it's like. And it's not really a street photography kind of lens. You can do it, and it adds a cool variety, but it's really inconvenient. You have to stand in all kinds of awkward spots to get enough in focus. Unless you're in a huge city with vast areas and distances that you can capture, it just really wasn't that great. And I'll talk about this later, but simplicity is really key for using the 200 to 400 range. So my first real serious shoot with this lens was with my friend Kareem. We went downtown Toronto to this cool location with some graffiti, and Kareem is a dance instructor, so he had all these cool moves and positions that he was putting himself into, and I was really guiding him, pushing him to go even further. But ultimately, this lens did really, really well during the shoot, and I learned a lot about shooting at this longer focal distance. And what I learned is that because when you zoom in, your focus is very narrow kind of subject area, what is in that area, the background, becomes even more important. Because it becomes even more flat and compressed and gives that kind of cardboard effect, it can do some really strange things if you have different colors and objects in different distances doing strange shapes. You really want to keep the background in one dimension or really unified. So similar colors, similar shapes, and similar textures. And you know, here's an example of, you know, something that's kind of crazy and then something that's more singular and simple. It just works a lot better. So with that shoot behind me, I really had a lot of confidence in high-end EF lenses adapting to the R6, unlike I really had ever before. This is really the first time I ever tried something nicer on this body. So I decided to trade up my 50mm 1.8 for a 1.4, which I heard is a much higher quality, better lens that's used by professionals even, maybe amateurs. And I took it on my next shoot with Karina. So Karina came back, we did our yearly creative shoot that seems to happen, spur of the moment. So I took out the 100 to 400 and the 50mm, and I shot with both of them to see what it was like shooting with two high-end lenses on the R6, and they both performed magically, fantastically. Compared to my shoot last year, if you watch that video, where all of my cheaper lenses really underperformed, this just blew it out of the water. Really, the choice of lens on this camera, when you go EF, really, really matters for the autofocus and triggering and hitting those shots. At this point, I'm really familiar with Karina and working with her. I'm really warmed up with the lens after shooting with Kareem, and it was all kind of fell into place. I had so many nice shots. It took me weeks to pour through those images, edit them all, and the video that we took at both scenes. That's why this video took so long, is because it was just, the shoots were so successful. I had a lot of work on my hands. But what I learned by pouring over the images in greater detail is this lens, again, is really meant for portraits. It's kind of drilled into me. Portraits for three-quarter or really kind of like head and chest. It's not really a full-body kind of lens, and I'll explain why. Because of that cardboard cutout feeling that it gives you of that high compression, if you look at these two shots of Karina side by side, shot in 50mm and 400, look at what it does with her arms and her legs. Everything feels flat in one shot, and the other one has all of this dimension, and I think it's that dimension that adds interest and flavor and makes a shot really interesting and appealing, whereas it's kind of boring looking at a flat shot like that. I think it's okay when you have a face and there's all kinds of expression and detail, but a full body shot in a really bland environment, because it flattens and blurs everything, it's really a little bit more boring. So I wouldn't recommend this for a full body portrait session. I'd keep it to, the three-quarter and headshot range, which it does magically. I mean, look at what it did to this portrait when it flattened and compressed a sunrise. It was just completely magical what it does. So again, stressing the importance of a background that is simple and unified. There's nothing else going on in these background shots. It's just the sunrise. And in that way, there's no distraction, and it just really brings the whole thing together. But if you look at this photo where you know, you've got all kinds of crazy stuff happening, it's not really working together and it's just becoming a distraction for the viewer. So the last 2 points, weight was a factor again. Shooting for about an hour with this lens, you'll get pretty tired. You won't give up, but it's definitely not an enjoyable, relaxing experience. You really got to put a lot of work, especially at that 400 range where things are getting really shaky. And what I've heard online is that shooting at like these extreme ranges with a model, it's really difficult to work together and communicate, but I didn't have that problem at all. It was very easy to communicate and work with all the models and people that I photographed. I had no issues communicating. 400 is long, but it's not that long where you can't kind of raise your voice a little bit and get your point across. So that was a non-factor, but I really, really love this lens. I would myself go pick this up, especially considering it's probably half the price of the RF 70-200, and it gets you kind of the same kind of focal ranges and even farther. It's stabilized, it's super sharp, great color. Why not pick this up? You know, if you have an adapter handy, I highly recommend it. So thanks for watching.